بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا وعظيمنا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع نفوسنا أبي القاسم محمد.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه الغر الميامين. الحمد لله الذي جعلنا من المتمسكين بولاية سيدي ومولاي علي بن أبي طالب.
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد.
الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. أما بعد، يقول الله في كتابه الكريم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها الرسول بلغ ما أنزل إليك من ربك، وإن لم تفعل فما بلغت رسالته، والله يعصمك من الناس، إن الله لا يهدي القوم الكافرين. The first of our salawat in honor of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
The second in honor of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali ibn Abi Talib.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
The third with your loudest voices in honor of the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad.
Respected scholars, brothers and sisters, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. The event of Ghadir is without a doubt the most famous event in the history of the religion of Islam. And indeed at the same time is seen as one of the most narrated events within the history of the religion. And arguably seen as the coronation of the leadership of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullah wa salamu
alayhi.
You will not find so many narrators of an event like the narrators of the day of Ghadir. At every century, from the 1st until the 14th century after Hijrah, and this year we are in the 14th century after Hijrah, you find that every century there have been scholars, both Sunni and Shia, who have declared that the day of Ghadir was a unanimous day, who have declared the event of Ghadir as being a unanimous event. Nobody within the Sunni or the Shia ulama has denied that the event of Ghadir took place. For you find that unanimous within the works is that Ali ibn Abi Talib definitely had a statement made about him at an area known as Khum. And the statement was, فَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَىٰ فَهَذَا عَلِيٌّ مَوْلَىٰ. That statement has been narrated in every generation of our brothers in Ahl al-Sunnah and in our books. If you look at the first generation of the companions, the famous of them, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Talha, Zubair, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Abdul Rahman bin Auf, others such as the Abadila like Abdullah bin Umar or Abdullah bin Abbas, or Abdullah bin Mas'ud, others such as Khuzaymah bin Thabit al-Ansari, Salman, Abu Dhar, Miqdad, Ammar. In that first generation, all of them have narrated that Rasulullah stopped at a place by the name Khum and made an announcement about Ali. In the generation after that, the likes of Sa'id ibn Jubair narrate the incident of Ghadir. In the generation after that, the likes of Sufyan al-Thawri narrate about the incident of Ghadir. In the generation after that, Imam al-Shafi'i narrates about what happened in Ghadir. In the generation after that, you find, for example, Imam al-Bukhari in his Tariq, not in the Sahih, in the Tariq, narrates the incident of Ghadir. In the generation after that, Imam al-Nasa'i narrates the incident of Ghadir. In the generation after that, you'll name the likes of Ghazali, Suyuti, Tahawi, Shawkani, all the most famous of the ulama of Ahl al-Sunnah. All of them say that the incident of Ghadir is a reliable incident. In other words, 1400 years of scholarship, all of them are unanimous that yes, there was a statement made. The statement was, فَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَىٰ فَهَذَا عَلِيٌّ مَوْلَىٰ. It was made in the last days of the life of Rasulullah. It was made in and around the period of the pilgrimage of the Prophet before he died. Therefore, you find there is no incident in the history of the religion of Islam which has been narrated from so many different people like the incident of Ghadir. That the likes of Abu Ja'far al-Tabari or Ibn Uqdah or the likes of others who have looked at this area have written books about the different chains of Ghadir. You see, a hadith may have one chain, correct? Ghadir has up to 250 different chains who say they were there at Ghadir and they saw what happened with Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen. Someone asks the question here. You say therefore that Ali ibn Abi Talib was chosen on the day of Ghadir, he was announced. We say yes. Say to Ahlul Sunnah, say that he was announced as Man Kuntu Mawla. Fahada Ali Mawla, we say yes. They said, then why is it that a lot of our brothers from Ahlul Sunnah do not take Ali ibn Abi Talib and do not take the incident of Ghadir like we take it? Say, what do you mean? Say, when you look around the world of Ahlul Sunnah, you ask them that do you know about the incident of Ghadir? You find that many of them will turn around and not know him. Therefore, the question arose that if the incident of Ghadir is so famous, why is it that many of Ahlul Sunnah have not taken it on as a theological principle? As in, if the incident of Al-Ghadir has been narrated by Dhahabi, by Bukhari, by Muslim, surely Ahlul Sunnah would turn around and say, wait, there it is, Ali ibn Abi Talib was announced as the successor of Rasulullah. There would be no doubt, there would be no discussion. There are three reasons why our brothers in Ahlul Sunnah have not taken Ali ibn Abi Talib's announcement as Ghadir into their lives. The first reason is a laziness and an unwillingness to read, which affects both the Shia and the Sunnah. What do I mean? Most of the Shia and the Sunnah don't know why they believe what they believe in, by the way. Let's make something very clear. Most Shia and Sunnah are simply following their forefathers. If you ask him, why do you believe what you believe? He says to you, listen, this is what I found my forefathers doing. If you're going to ask me, where is it in Quran? I haven't got a clue. Do I read Quran? Never. Do I know what my books of hadith are? I haven't got a clue. Most of the Shia and Sunni world are orphans. Orphans in which way? Not that they don't have parents. They don't have knowledge and literature. Imam used to say, a person who's an orphan is not one without a father or mother. He is someone without knowledge. When you look at our brothers in Ahlul Sunnah, most of their knowledge that they rely on is the Friday khutbah. And most Friday khutbahs are scared to go into historical analysis. Why? Because the moment you start touching touchy subjects, Aisha versus Ali al-Jamal, Muawiyah versus Ali al-Safin, suddenly everyone gets fidgety and the imams lose their jobs. Yes? Therefore, you found many of our brothers in Ahlul Sunnah, when they go to their mosques on a Friday, are not taught history. All they're taught very clearly, this is what it says, this law, this hadith, this hadith, this law, this hadith, this law. Analysis is forbidden. That means at the same time a person has to go out and read, yet you find the Shia and the Sunnah do not read. The Shia and the Sunnah are a group of Muslims who simply rely on what the Mawlana says in the majlis. If the Mawlana, if there were no majalis, the person would not go out and read. I guarantee you now, if you ask the Shia, you say to them, what's the most famous books in Ahlul Sunnah? They'll say to you, Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, Abu Dawood, and Ibn Majah. If you were to ask the Shia, what's your most famous books? You'll find them turning around saying, Nahj al-Balagha? What do you mean Nahj al-Balagha? Nahj al-Balagha is not one of our most famous. Nahj al-Balagha is a book of repute of Sharif al-Radi. But our canonical works are which? Al-Kafi, Man la yahdaruhu al-Faqih, Kitab al-Tahdib, and what? Kitab al-Istifsar. Yes, Tahdib al-Ahkam al-Istifsar. Many of the Shia will turn around and say, listen, I haven't heard of any of those names you just mentioned. Yes, and I've been Shia for about 50, 60 years. You find therefore the first reason many don't know about Ghadir is because many Muslims aren't willing to go out and read. If my father prays with his hands folded, so do I. And if my father prays with his hand by his side, so do I. If my father's called Uthman, then I have a certain ideology. And if my father was called Ali, then I have a certain ideology. If it was the other way around, it would not differ with me at all. The first reason most of Ahlul Sunnah don't know about Ghadir is because of the Muslim epidemic of a lack of reading. And I tell you, in 2014, if a parent is not knowledgeable, he might as well forget about his children's upbringing. I'm telling you from now. Because the way the kids are asking questions to us these days, we could not answer when we could not ask when we were younger. If we ask some of the questions we're asking when we were younger, we'd get a slap, correct or no? The children these days, if you're not knowledgeable, you're in trouble. And do not be surprised, there's a day when your child says, Mom, Dad, so you're telling me you believe in something, you don't even know what the proofs are for it? Therefore, the first reason, laziness. The second reason is what? Second reason is some do know about the incident of Ghadir, but they're scared to change from what they've been brought up on. What do I mean? Many, when they read the incident of Ghadir, they're like, you know what? Rationally, how could the Prophet Muhammad leave the world without appointing or announcing a successor? It doesn't make any sense. How could the man who doesn't leave his house without appointing a successor, doesn't leave Mecca for Hunayn without Itab bin Usaid, doesn't leave Tabuk without Ali ibn Abi Talib in Medina, how could he leave the whole Ummah without a successor? No one, when they think about this, no one accepts it. How could the man who came to guide mankind leave it for a group who 23 years ago were pagans to make their decisions? Surely he would tell them rationally that this man is my successor. Not by implicit indication, explicitly. He will make them all stop somewhere in the heat of the hottest of Arabia and then tell them there and then, everybody listen, this is the announcement. Some of our brothers from Al-Sunnah, when they hear this, they think to themselves, you know what, this makes sense. Surely the Prophet Muhammad would not leave the world without appointing or announcing successor. He wouldn't implicitly saying that so-and-so led prayers. That's not a designation. That's just a merit. Surely he would have announced. But when they want to change, they think, hold on, I lose all my friends. I lose all my family. My wife may leave me. The children may leave me. My parents may leave me. Sometimes it's not easy to come to the path of Ahlul Bayt. Some of us should be thanking Allah every day that we're born in the path of Ahlul Bayt. Because for someone to leave his whole path to come towards the path of Ahlul Bayt is not easy. It's a major sacrifice. Yes, there are many out there who know Ali ibn Abi Talib, with all his attributes, was definitely the best man for Khilafah. They knew very well, but inside themselves they begin to ask themselves, if Ali ibn Abi Talib was announced at Ghadir, then there's an X on certain personalities later on, correct? And if I've been brought up loving those personalities and then I realize that, hold on, those personalities, one becomes caliph, then he puts his best friend, then he puts his daughters in power, then his daughter fights Ali later on. You begin to see everything unwind, then you begin to think, hold on a minute, have I been lied to? Have I been deceived? Therefore, the second group are scared that they want to accept Ghadir, but they're worried, what are my parents and my families going to say? Imagine now, all of us in Allentown, this is our friend circle, correct or no? Imagine one of us leaves the school of Ahlul Bayt. I guarantee you the whole friend circle will not talk to the person again, correct or no? Who are those of us who are Shia? We ban them. How about the one who leaves Shiaism? Anyway. Those who are Shia, we ban them. How about the one who leaves Shiaism? Therefore, the second reason, Ghadir, they know about it, but scared. The third reason why some will not accept Ghadir is what? It's a very interesting reason. Who told you that the way we see Ghadir is the way Ahlul Sunnah are made to see Ghadir? What do I mean? You see, when you ask our brothers from Ahlul Sunnah, what happened at the day of Ghadir? What did the Prophet mean when he said, فَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَى فَهَذَا عَلِيُ مَوْلَى. You know what they say? Yemen, Khalid ibn Walid, booty. Say, sorry? Say, Yemen, Khalid ibn Walid, and the taxes of Yemen. Say, hold on, hold on, hold on. What's that got to do with Man Kuntu Mawla Fahad Ali Mawla? Say yes. Man Kuntu Mawla Fahad Ali Mawla means what? There was a fight in Yemen involving Ali and Khalid. Rasulullah resolved it at Hajj. You see, sometimes you think that Ghadir, as seen by us, is seen by everyone the same, correct or no? One of the biggest tricks played in Islamic history was to change the context of Ghadir to push it away from Ali ibn Abi Talib. When you ask any follower of Ahlul Bayt, what happened al-Ghadir? They say Imam Ali's hand was risen in front of 100,000 people and they were told that Ali ibn Abi Talib is the Prophet's successor, correct or no? You go to our Ahlul Sunnah brothers today, those who have studied, you ask them, do you know al-Ghadir? They're like, yes. Do you agree with it? Yes. What happened? Yemen, Khums, Khalid. You say, excuse me, what are you talking about? I say, well, haven't you read our books properly? So we have. I said, do you believe in al-Ghadir? I said, yes, we do. But it doesn't refer to Ali. Because they hated Ali, Rasulullah made an announcement because the word Mawla means friend. So when Rasulullah said, فَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَى فَهَذَا عَلِيُ مَوْلَى, because they didn't like him, so Rasulullah said, whoever I am a friend of, Ali is his friend as well. You need to understand the delicacy of Ghadir is not as easy as it seems. To most of us, because we are in the mosque and hear the same lectures, we assume the whole world sees the day of Ghadir as we do. Not at all. You enter a proper debate with one of our brothers from another school in Islam. He'll tell you, what are you talking about? Ali ibn Abi Talib was chosen. Ali ibn Abi Talib had a skirmish. And Rasulullah resolved the skirmish. And he told the companions, من كنت مولا فهذا علي مولا. Question, was Ali ibn Abi Talib with Rasulullah on the way to Hajj that year or no? Answer, no. If you ask many followers of the Bayt, when Rasulullah left Medina to go to Mecca for Hajj that year, was Ali ibn Abi Talib with him? Not at all. Of course he wasn't with him. Ali ibn Abi Talib was in Yemen. Rasulullah was in Medina. They were in two completely different areas. The moment you understand the politics behind Medina and Yemen, then you'll understand Ghadir. There may be some turning around thinking, hold on, I thought the whole of my life that Rasulullah went to Hajj from Medina towards Mecca and Ali was with him. No, he wasn't with him. He was in Yemen. Let me explain to you the background of Ghadir in order that we're able to alleviate this myth. Because now on the internet, we are being bombarded that Ghadir was the day Rasulullah resolved a fight between Khalid and Ali. And that's it, nothing else. There was no announcement and there was nothing more. And they are right when they say Ali was in Yemen. Ali ibn Abi Talib wasn't in Medina when Rasulullah went for Hajj. Ali ibn Abi Talib was in Yemen. Let me try and explain this to you in the following stages in order that we understand how to counteract this whole issue. Number one, what was Ali ibn Abi Talib doing in Yemen? Number two, when he came to meet Rasulullah outside Mecca, when he saw his companions joining him, why was he angered with them? Number three, when the companions complained to Rasulullah about Ali, what did Rasulullah say about him? Number four, when the announcement of Ghadir was made, how does Surah 33 verse 6 put the context on Man Kuntu Mawla? Number five, did Imam Ali ever say Ghadir was about his imama or about his fight with Khalid? And how does the fact that he mentions it as the issue of his imama destroy the argument about Khalid? Number six, did any of the companions of Imam Ali ever mention Ghadir? Number seven, did any of the Ahlul Bayt ever stop at Ghadir and mention it as the day Imam was chosen? And number eight, which of the companions lost their lives in order that the day of Ghadir would be preserved forever? And what were those companions doing next to his bed on a night like this? Let me examine in order that you understand Ghadir inside out, because there's a number of key questions here. Ali ibn Abi Talib was sent by Rasulullah in the 10th year after Hijrah. After Mubahala, he was sent to the land of Yemen. He was sent there, Khalid ibn al-Walid was sent there, and Abu Musa al-Ash'ari was sent there. Rasulullah is in Medina. Ali has gone to Yemen. In other words, they are far away from each other at that time. Imam had two issues he needed to sort out in Yemen. The first issue Imam Ali needed to sort out in Yemen was to bring the people of Yemen towards Islam. Many places had become Muslim, but Yemen was a bit difficult to bring towards Islam. Therefore, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib had to go to Yemen. Khalid ibn Walid went, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari went. When Khalid ibn Walid went to the people of Yemen, instead of inviting them with honor, with wisdom, with kindness, he invited them with harshness. When he invited them with harshness, these people of Yemen wanted no interest in Islam. You see, Islam, if you invite someone, as the Quran says, with hikmah and with maw'idah hasana, then a person loves the religion, correct or no? If I meet someone now who's a non-Muslim and he asks me, what is Islam? And I'm like, Islam is jihad in Afghanistan. That person turns around and says, bro, what are you talking about? You want me to join the religion? I want to run away. If I talk with someone, he talks to me about Islam, he says, what is Islam? I say, Islam is a religion that seeks to protect the property, the honor, the intellect, the life, and the religion of a fellow human being. I say, yes, welcome. Khalid Walid went to the people of Yemen. They heard his Islam. They said, get out. 6 months he was trying to make the Muslims. They couldn't make them. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, within a couple of days, converted the whole of Yemen towards the religion of Islam. Yes? Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, the way he speaks, that's why they call him Nahj al-Balagha, the peak of eloquence. His eloquence alone is far above any companion of Rasulullah. Yes? علي بن أبي طالب, forget his bravery, forget that every Sufi has to go back to him. His eloquence alone is in a different league to anyone else. These Yemenis joined. The other task Imam had with these companions who had gone to Yemen is to collect the taxes of people living in Yemen, correct or no? We had mentioned mubahala, when a non-Muslim lives in a Muslim state, you have to pay taxes, correct or no? You pay these taxes, Imam had gone to collect, some of these companions had collected as well. What would they collect? Some would collect gold, silver, armor, depending on what the expedition was. The narration mentions that Rasulullah was informed by Allah, you have to go on Hajj. Rasulullah had never done Hajj in his life. His first Hajj was a year before or a few months before he died, correct or no? His first Hajj was called what? Was in the 10th year after Hijra. Rasulullah was informed by his Lord, you and your companions have to leave Mecca and you have to go towards Hajj. What did he do? First, he ensured a letter was sent to Yemen. Send a letter to Yemen. Tell Ali ibn Abi Talib to meet me on the outskirts of Mecca. So we will go into Mecca together. Imam Ali is where? Yemen, correct? Rasulullah is where? Medina. Rasulullah gathers all the companions. They all come with him. They go and wear their ihram where? Those of you been to Hajj, when we leave Medina, where do we wear ihram? Masjidin Shajara. May Allah bless those of you who haven't been to Hajj. May you all go this year, inshallah. And those of you who have been to Hajj, may Allah bless you to go even many years, inshallah. We go to Masjid al-Shajara, for that's where Rasulullah said to Allah on the night of Mi'raj, لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك. We go, they go to Masjid al-Shajara, all of them wore their ihram. Some of them brought the animals with them, others didn't bring their animals with them. And their intention was what? That we'll go towards the house if Allah honors us, either Umrah, if after Umrah did Tamattu, inshallah we do Hajj, correct or no? Because you first start off doing what? Umrah. You finish Umrah, you do Ibadah for the next few days, or in some cases you chill for the next few days. And then what do you do? And then you go on to do your main Hajj. Now, Rasulullah stopped there at Masjid al-Shajara, all of them wore their ihram. As they were leaving, it was quite a walk. As they were leaving, they said, Ya Rasulullah, our feet are hurting us. It's quite a long journey. So he said, go and get some milk, rub it with the sand and put your feet, let it rub on your feet. The Sahaba rubbed their feet. They said, we have never walked like we walked after that day. Yes. Rasulullah helped them. All of them came together and they left 5 days before Dhul Hijjah. Yes. Ghadir is when? 18th of Dhul Hijjah. Yes. They left 5 days before Dhul Hijjah. They went down from Medina. Where are we going? To Mecca. Yes. Ali ibn Abi Talib is where? Yemen. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib went ahead of his companions who were with him in Yemen. He said to them, listen, he said, I am going to meet the Prophet Muhammad. He has told me to come and meet him before he gets to the Hajj. I will go ahead of you. All of you come and meet me. I'm going to leave behind some clothing, some armor, some gold, some silver. And I want you to come and join me there. When Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib went, he met Rasulullah. They congratulated each other. He said to him, how many animals do you have for sacrifice? He said, I have 34. He said, how many do you have? He said, I have 66. He said, very good. He said to him, are you ready? He said, we're all ready, Ya Rasulullah. The others came and joined. The others, when they came and joined, our brothers in Ahlul Sunnah, what do they say? Say, one group of the others came and said, Ya Rasulullah, we have a complaint to make. And another one, Ali ibn Abi Talib, complained about them. The first group complained to Rasulullah that Ali ibn Abi Talib took more of the taxes of Yemen for himself than he gave to us. Yes? So supposedly Khalid ibn al-Walid and Buraydah were angered at Ali ibn Abi Talib's behavior. And they had a hatred for him and they came and told Rasulullah about this hatred. Likewise, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, when he saw his companions joining on the outskirts of Mecca, he said, what are you doing wearing this armor? What are you doing wearing this cloth? His deputy said, I gave it to them. He said, didn't I tell you no one can use this? This is belonging to the Muslims. What do you mean all of you are wearing it? Rasulullah distributes it as he wants. They were angered, they came to Rasulullah. When they came to Rasulullah, understand this point. Is this after Hajj or before Hajj? After, this is what? Before Hajj. This Hajj hasn't occurred yet. They're still on the outskirts of Mecca. They came, Khalid and Buraydah complained to Rasulullah. Point here. Our brothers in Ahlul Sunnah always tell us the Sahaba all loved each other. What a myth. I don't know how long this myth is going to continue for you. Yani. Only a rational human being, yes, will understand what a myth. But they all love. So Talha and Zubair fighting Ali and Jamal is love. Or Amr ibn al-As fighting fighting Ammar ibn Yasir and Safin is love. Or Fatima al-Zahra dying angry with the first Khalifa in Sahih al-Bukhari is love. Or Khalid, okay, forget all of these. You're saying Khadir is that Rasulullah put Ali's hand up and said, whoever I'm his friend, now Ali's his friend. I don't like you being enemies of Ali. That must mean there was hatred to Ali, correct or no? That must mean there's a complaint about Ali. Hold on. If Khalid is already hating Ali while Rasulullah is alive, what's he going to do to Ali's family after Rasulullah dies? I thought all of them loved each other. I thought Khalid is in Jannah, Ali is in Jannah, every Tom, Dick and Harry on this earth went to Jannah. Correct or no? I turn around, I see before Rasulullah dies, Khalid is angered, hates Ali. Hold on, if these are men I should trust, I'm worried. Because Ya Rasulullah, the moment you die, I don't know what these men are going to do to your family. Yes or no? So Rasulullah looked at them. He said, what's your issue? They said, Ali ibn Abi Talib has angered us because of what's happened in Yemen. He said, no one thing. Never anger Ali ibn Abi Talib. For whatever Ali ibn Abi Talib does is in line with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ali ibn Abi Talib is harsh against his enemies, but he's never deceitful in his religion. None of you should ever anger Ali ibn Abi Talib. I don't accept this from any of you. That's it. Case closed. This idea that Khalid ibn Walid, the reason he had a fight, so Rasulullah stopped everyone at Ghadir to try and resolve the issue. The issue was resolved before Hajj, not after Hajj. The issue, Ghadir, happened after Hajj, correct or no? Hajj finished, Eid finished, everyone was going back home, Ghadir happened. The issue of Khalid ibn Walid in Yemen was resolved way before. But you see, subhanAllah, what they've done? Now on the internet, everywhere, there are now articles. Shia, let's tell you what happened at Ghadir. Khalid had a problem with Ali and Rasulullah resolved it. My first point always is, if Khalid had a problem with Ali, you put yourself in a right mess, yes? Because if Khalid has a problem with Ali, these Sahaba certainly don't like each other. That's number one. But number two, the issue was resolved before Hajj. What's the best proof, therefore, that Ghadir had nothing to do with a fight between Khalid and Imam Ali and was completely about Imam Ali's announcement? I'll tell you what the proofs are. The first proof is the sermon of Ghadir. You see, Hajj finished. Everyone was going back home. I read an interesting article on the internet I'd like to share with you, yes? Someone wrote, why doesn't Rasulullah say to everyone at Hajj that Ali is his successor, yes? Why does he have to wait for Ghadir? Everyone's come to Hajj, correct or no? You see, now this year we all go to Hajj, correct? Is it better that you make an announcement at Jeddah Airport? Or is it better that you make the announcement at Arafah? Someone will say, it's better you make the announcement at Arafah, because all the Muslims have to be at Arafah between that period of Dhuhr and Maghrib, correct or no? Whereas Jeddah Airport, some might be going, and this is what the article says, some of the Iraqis have to go to Iraq, yes? MashaAllah, now our concern is who the Iraqis, yes? The article says these Shia are stupid. The Iraqis, they're not gonna, after Hajj, you see Mecca's here, Medina's here, correct or no? The Iraqis are not gonna head towards Ghadir, Khum and Medina. The Iraqis are going to take a different direction. So they said these Shia are stupid because the Iraqis had to go a different direction. If Rasulullah had done Ali's announcement as Hajj, then the Iraqis could have listened. I'm stupid? Yes. So which Iraqis? So the people of Kufa, they couldn't hear Ali ibn Abi Talib's announcement because they would go a different direction to Ghadir. There were no Muslims in Kufa at the time, Habibi. Yes? When you want to be a historian, make sure you have class as a historian, yes? Don't mess about with the historians, yes? Hold yourself back sometimes. He says the people of Kufa would have missed the announcement. Kufa was founded 7 years after Ghadir, yes? Relax. When you try and say that we are stupid about what we believe, there were no Iraqi Shia at the time, there were no Iraqi Sunni, there were no Iraqi Muslims. Sa'ad bin Abi Waqqas founded Kufa 7 years after Hajj. Don't worry, there were no Iraqis booking plane tickets to go to Hajj that year, yes? He says, how about the Yemenis? The Yemenis, Ali ibn Abi Talib just made them Muslim. What do you think? The first day of Islam, they're going to book a ticket to go to Hajj? No! Rasulullah, number three, doesn't wait to say, in my opinion, the announcement should be here. Rasulullah waits for the heavens, correct or no? Rasulullah waits. When does the heaven reveal to me? That's when I will announce, correct or no? He says, and the narration mentions, that Rasulullah, the people who are all going back. Majority of the people who have come to Hajj have come from which country, which city? Majority of people who come to Hajj, from where? Medina, correct or no? So the way back from Mecca to Medina, that's the majority of the people, yes? Where was Islam, realistically? Where did Islam flourish? Medina, correct or no? Today you could say the Lebanese, today you could say the Syrians. Let's say there was a handful, maybe, a handful. The majority of the people are going which way? Medina, yes? So, Rasulullah, when he's returning from Mecca to Medina, can Rasulullah himself say, well, you know what, I feel like announcing Ali ibn Abi Talib now. وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ Rasulullah doesn't speak of his own will, he speaks of revelations from his Lord. Rasulullah, returning back from Mecca, receives the revelation, Surah 5, verse 67 of the Qur'an. يَا أَيُّهَا الرَّسُولُ Now, when you read a surah, the number of the surah is vital. Sometimes people ask me, why do you quote numbers and verses all the time? Why don't you just say the verse and just quote? What I say is, when you hear a surah, if it's number 5 or number 9 or number 2, these are normally the surahs with the last verses of the Qur'an. The Qur'an is not a book in chronological order, correct or no? You know, sometimes people come and say to me, the Qur'an, is it a book of chronological order? No, if it was, then what should be surah number 1? Alaq. What surah number 1 of the Qur'an? Fatiha, correct or no? But what should be surah number 1 if it was chronological? Iqra. But Iqra is which number? 96. The Qur'an is not chronological. But one thing you do know, Surah Al-Ma'idah, its verses are the final ayat to be revealed. Surah 5, verse 67. Ya ayyuhar rasulu, balligh. O messenger of God, preach what's been bestowed upon you. Now please, I beg all of you, listen to the ayah. Ya ayyuhar rasulu, balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik. O prophet of God, O messenger of God, preach what's been bestowed upon you. Wait. He's already preached hajj, he's preached fasting, he's preached prayer, he's preached zakat, he's preached khums. You want my proof? Hajj, walillahi ala nas hajjul bayt. Sawm, yes, ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyam kama kutiba alal ladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Salah, aqimu as-salah, aqim as-salah. Zakat, aqimu as-salah wa atul zakat. Khums, wa'lamu anna ma ghanimtum min shay'in fa inna lillahi khumsa, wa lirrasul, wa lidhil qurba. Jihad, ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, man yartada minkum an dinihi fasawfa yati Allah biqawmin yuhibbuhum wa yuhibbunah, adhillatan 'alal mu'minin, 'izzatan 'alal kafirin, yujahiduna fi sabilillah. أمر بالمعروف والنهي عن المنكر وأمر بالمعروف وانهى عن المنكر All of these have been done, correct? Now an ayah comes down and says, Oh messenger of God, preach. Preach what? I've done everything now, correct or no? Preach what's been bestowed upon you. وَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلْ فَمَا If you don't preach this, your message is finished. What? Hold on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying something to the Prophet Muhammad. 22 and a half years of message, Allah is telling the Prophet Muhammad, if you don't do what I've just commanded you to do, Islam is finished as a religion. Wait, Quran, tick. Salah, tick. Marriage, tick. Hajj, tick. Psalm, tick. Amr bin Ma'ruf, tick. Jihad, tick. Hold on, you're telling me Mecca, all his struggles, Medina, all his struggles. If he doesn't do something, and we said Surah 5, its ayahs are the last ayahs. Do you agree or no? Whenever you hear Surah 5, you know that this is the end of the Quran. Correct or no? Surah Al-Ma'idah. Allah tells the Prophet, O Messenger, preach what's been bestowed upon you. If you don't, your message is incomplete. وَاللَّهُ يَحْصَبُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ And Allah will protect you from the people. Do not worry. Wait. Why do you need to say to him, I'll protect you? Whatever this message is going to bring about envy, hatred, opposition, anger. Correct or no? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Prophet what? بَلِّغْ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ عَدْ غَدِيَ الْخُمِ Muslim narrates that the Prophet stopped. Today in Google, go and type tonight. Sahih Muslim, type خُم. K-H-U-M-M, the whole narration comes out. Muslim narrates from Zayd bin Arqam, and I'll come back to Zayd bin Arqam in a few minutes. He narrates from Zayd bin Arqam, he narrates what? He narrates that Rasulullah stopped at Khum. And you know the Ghadir Khum speech, you think it took 10 minutes, 15 minutes? 3 hour speech. We only hear Man Kuntu Mawla, it was 3 hours. First he asked them, gather saddles of the camels, 100,000. The lowest number I've seen is 90,000. And the highest number I've seen is 120,000. 1, 2, 4. Gather the saddles. They gather the saddles. Everyone, imagine that many saddles. There was a certain amount at a certain angle which everyone could see him. Then Jibra'il says to him, listen to the narration. He said, Jibra'il said to me, those who've gone ahead, send people to call them back. And those who are still behind, wait for them. You see, because someone might turn around and say, when you get to Ghadir, there might be people who've gone other ways. So someone's got to go after them and tell them, come back. And there are still some coming from Hajj, wait for them. He waited, then he began his sermon. Then he said to the people, O people, my Lord has informed me that my time is near. Yes? Have I told you everything? They said, yes, you have. Have I told you death is the truth, resurrection is the truth, there's a day of judgment for all of you? They said, yes, you have, Ya Rasulallah. He said to them, and who is your Lord? And they said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, he is my Mawla as well. Then he said the most fundamental of lines. Firstly, what did he say? This is in Sahih Muslim. I want all of you, if you can, I beg you tonight, Google it. I leave behind for you two weighty things. If you hold on to them, you will never, ever go astray. The Quran and my Ahlul Bayt. My Ahlul Bayt. My Ahlul Bayt. Wait, wait, wait. Every Friday khutbah in the Sunni world, I will say every, and I'm proud to say every, and you can take me to task on saying every, yes? Go to Allentown's mosque. Go to New York's mosque. Go to Chicago's mosque. Go to LA's mosque. Go to London, Birmingham, Sheffield, Leeds, Blackburn. Go Pakistan, Karachi, Lahore, Islamabad, India, Bombay. Go every Sunni mosque on this earth. You will find them in the Friday khutbah saying, Rasulullah said, I leave behind for you two weighty things, the Quran and my Sunnah. I beg you, show me where. Where did he say Quran and Sunnah? Where? Why'd you lie to your people? Why'd you lie? Why? What's Ahlul Bayt done wrong to you? What have they done wrong? Why the lie? What's wrong with saying what Sahih Muslim says? Do you know the Hadith Quran and Sunnah is not in Bukhari, nor in Muslim, nor in Tirmidhi, nor in Nasa'i, nor in Abu Dawood, nor in Ibn Majah? I defy anyone watching this lecture, whether it's here, whether it's on YouTube, whether it's on the television. I defy anyone. Show me this Hadith that every Friday prayer you say, Rasulullah said, I leave behind the Quran and my Sunnah. Show me in the six main books of Al-Sunnah, where is the Hadith? Why lie? Don't you fear a day of judgment? A day when you neglected the rights of Rasulullah's family? Bukhari, nothing. Muslim, Muslim says Rasulullah said, I leave Quran. Do you know why this Hadith is the most powerful Hadith? Because it proves the imamate of Ahlul Bayt. Quran is chosen by Allah or no? That means whoever's next to it is chosen by Allah. Quran is Allah's words written. That means whoever's next to it is Allah's words walking. Quran is Allah's spokesman. That means whoever's next to the Quran is Allah's spokesman on earth. The most powerful Hadith in the school of Ahlul Bayt, Quran and Ahlul Bayt. Ahlul Sunnah, I feel sorry, and if any of my brothers are watching this in my lecture tonight, any of them around the world, go and ask your Mawlanas, where is this Hadith, Quran and Sunnah? Why have you lied? They'll say, Malik narrates it in his Muwatta. And even Malik says, it was told to me that one day Rasulullah said, I leave behind Quran my Sunnah. It was told to me. There's not even a chain. Yes? Malik came 100 years after Rasulullah says, it was told to me. Yes? Quran and my Ahlul Bayt, Rasulullah said, hold on to them, you will never go astray. And they will never separate from me. Until the pool of Kawthar, yes? And then in Sahih Muslim it's written, they asked him, Ya Rasulullah, who are your Ahlul Bayt? He says, the sons of Ali ibn Abi Talib, salawatullah wa salamu alayhi. Let's have a second louder salawat, please.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
sons of Aqil, sons of Abbas. Now, sons of Abbas is a clever one. Bani Abbas had to throw in them. Yes, but anyway, that's a different story. Therefore, you found that then he said what? O people, this is the most important ayah in the whole sermon of Ghadir. Why? Mawla can mean friend. Mawla can mean slave. Mawla can mean master. Mawla, they're right. It has 23 different meanings. In Arabic, like in English, when a word has many meanings, what do? You look for the context of the word, correct? Don't you look for context? If I say someone is the lion of the sea, does that mean he's the lion swimming in the sea? No. It means that he's the master of the seas, correct or no? The word Mawla, in Arabic, we must have a qareena for it, a context. Rasulullah, before he said, فَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَى, he first quoted Surah 33, verse 6. He said, أَلَسْتُ أَوْلَى بِكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Don't I have an authority on all of you more than you have on yourselves? Khalid ibn al-Walid's story is finished. Gone. Because now the word Awla shows it's not about a friendship rivalry. Now it's about authority. أَلَسْتُ أَوْلَى بِكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ. Don't I have authority above yourselves more than you have on yourself? Can't I demand anything from you? Can't I prohibit anything for you? They said yes. Four times, Ahmed bin Hanbal says, he then said, فَمَنْ كُنْتُ مَوْلَى فَهَذَا عَلِيٌّ مَوْلَى. Now Ali ibn Abi Talib is the first. Man kuntu mawla, fa man kuntu mawla, fa hada Ali mawla. Allahumma wali man wala, wa adi man ada, wa ansur man nasara, wa khdul man khadala. Oh Allah, be a guardian to whoever takes Ali ibn Abi Talib as his guardian. And be an enemy to whoever takes Ali ibn Abi Talib as his enemy. Yes? And whoever oppresses Ali, ya Allah, put the oppression on them. And whoever helps Ali ibn Abi Talib, ya Allah, help them. Correct or no? For the truth revolves around Ali ibn Abi Talib. Yes? All of a sudden, Hassan bin Thabit came to Rasulullah. He said, ya Rasulullah, can I recite poetry about this? He began to recite. Rasulullah praised him. Then Rasulullah said, everyone come and congratulate me on this day. He had raised Imam Ali's hand. The hadith say they could see the whiteness of the armpits of Rasulullah and Ali. Everyone could see. Everyone came. They said, Bakhin, Bakhin, congratulations. Congratulations. Everyone came to congratulate Imam Ali. Would you congratulate someone just because Rasulullah sorted out a fight between him and his friend? Yes, you'd come and say, oh, well done. It's been sorted out. Good, good. Can we go out? Baba, think with your head. Everyone came, congratulated Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. One by one, Bakhin, Bakhin, Hussein Abu Talib. The question is, when Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib thinks of Ghadir, did he refer to it as a fight between him and Khalid or his imama? His imama, of course. Many times Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib would stand in front of people. You know, the beginning of the Battle of Jabal, when Talha and Zubair fought Imam Ali, Imam came to Talha. He said, Talha, weren't you there on the day of Ghadir? When Rasulullah said, من كنت مولى فهذا علي مولى اللهم والي من والى وعاد من عدا وانصر من نصر وغن. Weren't you there? Wasn't that the day I was chosen? You can go and read the hadith in the Mustadrak of Al-Hakim. Further than that, on the day of the Ruhba, yes? Zayd bin Arqam was sitting down. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib turned around. He said, which one of you was in the day of Ghadir when I was chosen? Which one of you? Today you all left me. You chose others. You went and sided with others when you knew Rasulullah announced me on the day of Ghadir. When Allah said what? You know the ayah after Ghadir happened. You know which ayah was revealed? Surah 5, verse number 3. Which ayah? You know how the ayah begins? It begins by talking about which food is haram for you, correct? So sometimes people say, this has got nothing to do with Ghadir. It talks about which food is haram for you. Yes, you're right. Surah 5, verse 3 begins about which food is haram. But an ayah in the Quran can talk about one topic and switch in the middle, correct or no? Ayah about the wives of Rasulullah switches to being about Ahlul Bayt, correct? Surah 33, verse 33. The first part speaks about what? Which food is haram? Then do you know what the ayah suddenly says? Today is the day that the disbelievers despair of your religion. اليوم يائس الذين كفروا يس من دينكم فلا تخشوهم يس فلا تخشوهم واخشوهم do not fear them fear me اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم وأتممت عليكم نعمتي ورضيت لكم الإسلام دينا today is the day I have completed your religion and perfected it with the wilaya of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib صلوات الله وسلام
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
no doubt that ayah came down would disbelievers despair because of haram food tell me the honest truth yes if I was a disbeliever in Mecca ayah came down about haram food I'm like oh God these guys have defeated us they've made foods haram what a thing The ayah said, today they despair. Today I've completed my religion and perfected my bounty. يا أهل بيت النبوة ومعدن الرسالة ومختلف الملائكة ومهبط الوحي وخزان العلم بموالاتكم تمت الكلمة وعظمت النعمة in زيارة الجامعة. We say, therefore Imam Ali was standing with his companions. He said, who was there when the Quran said, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم? Who was there on the day of Ghadir? Do not lie. Say who you are. Then he looked at Zayd bin Arqam. He said, Zayd, you were there. You're the one who narrates this. Tell me. He said, you know, Ali, there's a lot I've forgotten. You know, sometimes we feel we're oppressed in this world and no one's oppressed like Amir al-Mu'mineen. Put all your oppressions on the side. Wallah, Ali ibn Abi Talib, what you went through for Islam and at the end, they forget. He says, you've forgotten. He said, you know, I've forgotten more things than I can remember. He said, so you don't remember about Ghadir? He said, no. He said, you know what? I can't remember. You know what happened to Zayd bin Arqam? He was affected by blindness. He was affected by blindness after this incident. When he realized that the blindness was definitely because he denied Ali ibn Abi Talib's right, he began to narrate all the merits of Ali. Every gathering he'd go in, he'd narrate the merits. And he is the Zayd bin Arqam when Ibn Ziyad was poking the teeth of Imam al-Hussein in Kufa and poking the eyes of Imam al-Hussein. That same Zayd bin Arqam was sitting there. He said, oh, Ibn Ziyad, what are you doing? I saw Rasulullah kiss those lips. I saw Rasulullah kiss those lips and now you poke them with your stick. That Zayd bin Arqam was a witness. Imam would say, don't you remember Ghadir? I was chosen. He said that to Anas bin Malik. He said that to others. Did others even say this? Yes. You find Fatima al-Zahra in her khutbah herself says you left the man chosen. Yes. The man whose guardianship was given to you. You find Imam al-Sadiq whenever he'd come past Ghadir. You know Ghadir is a pond. Yes. It's a pond. Whenever he'd come past the pond or the oasis, he'd say this is the day where Ali ibn Abi Talib was chosen by Allah as the Imam of the Muslims. This is where And the celebration of Eid al-Ghadir is the greatest Eid within the religion of Islam. Yes? Imam al-Sadiq says, the greatest Eid, not Adha, not Fitr. The greatest Eid is Eid al-Ghadir. Because Allah completed his religion and perfected it with the Imam of Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. That's why the disbelievers, they despaired. Because they thought Muhammad's dying. Surely now we can take over. Now Ali has been chosen. Now we despair. This religion, while Ali ibn Abi Talib is alive, is not going to be easy to take over. And that's why you find when the news reached Medina, Al-Harith bin Nu'man heard Ali ibn Abi Talib was chosen at Ghadir. Al-Harith bin Nu'man heard. There's a surah in the Quran, surah 70, verse 1. If ever tonight you can open the surah, surah 70, verse 1. Do you know what it says? A questioner asked about a punishment that was inevitable. I've never seen an ayah of the Quran open like this. A questioner asked about a punishment that was inevitable. Which questioner? What's he asked? He went to Rasulullah. He said to him, Ya Rasulullah, you told us to pray, we prayed. You told us to fast, we fasted. You told us hajj, we went hajj. You told us zakat, we done zakat. Is the announcement of Ali ibn Abi Talib from you or from God? Rasulullah looked at him. Hasn't the man asked a question which is going to bring a punishment or no? Rasulullah looked at him and said, I don't speak of my own words. I speak of revelation of my Lord. It's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know what this man did? He came out of his eyes and said, Ya Allah, if the announcement about Ali is from you, let a rock fall on my head and kill me. Do you know how much envy there was to Ali ibn Abi Talib in Medina at the time? It was on boiling point. Ali had Fatima. Ali was victorious at Badr, Uhud, Khandaq, Khaybar, Hunayn. Ali was the akh of Rasulullah. The envy was reaching boiling point. He said, Ya Allah, if the appointment of Ali is from you, let a rock fall on my head. Sa'ala sa'ilun bi'adhabi waqi'. A questioner asked a question where there's punishment is inevitable, yes? You question the mouth of Rasulullah, you think you're not going to be punished? You question the mouth of Rasulullah, you say, is this from you? And then you turn to Allah, say, if it's from you, then punish me? The hadiths, even in Sunni literature, you find the hadiths mentioning a rock fell on his head and killed him. Yes? Therefore you find what? You find that that happened in Medina, but the companions of Imam Ali never ever let go of Khadir, yes? Subhanallah, sometimes his lovers, Hassan ibn Thabit, done poetry. Amr ibn al-As even done poetry on Khadir, and he hated Ali ibn Abi Talib. And then his companions, each one of them, made sure the world knew about Khadir. Ammar ibn Yasir at Safin said, oh, Amir Muawiyah, you don't know the man chosen on the day of Khadir. Adi ibn Hatim told them, you don't know the man chosen on the day of Khadir. Every Sahabi of Imam Ali, Hujr ibn Adi, Al-Asbagh ibn Nubata, Sa'sa'a ibn Sawhan, Habib ibn Amr, one by one, Amr ibn Hamad al-Khuzai, one by one, would say, we will never forget the day of Khadir. The day of Khadir stays in our hearts forever. It was the day Islam was perfected with the imamate of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Those certain companions on a night like this were sitting by the bed of Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib in Kufa, yes? Because on a night like this, the night of the 20th, you know, normally when the Imam pass away, they pass away, let's say the same night. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib, three nights with a head that was injured and full of poison, yes? Of all the men, you would not want it to happen to the son of Abu Talib. And I want to ask all of you today, take your hearts to Najaf. And I want you to take your hearts as well to when your father was in a state of illness in his last moments. How much pain did you have when you saw your father in a state of illness, yes? When you're told that your father, that's it, he's gone now. There's no more of your father. How much pain does that bring about for you? I want you to think about Sayyidah Zainab on a night like this. I beg you, yes? Ya Sayyidah Zainab, we miss your grave in Sham. Ya Sayyidah, ya Bibi, please allow us return to Sham. Please let us sit by your grave. On a night like this, Zainab is next to her father. Kulthum, the tears are shed, yes? Hassan and Hussein are by their father. But at a time like this as well, the companions of Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, his best friends, all of them came, they were all sitting by his bed. Wallah, when you hear this narration, the narration breaks your heart, yes? These companions were all by the bed of Imam Ali. On one side, Hujr ibn Adi. On another side, Sa'sa'a ibn Sawhan. On another side, Amr ibn Hamak al-Khuzai. On another side, Al-Asbagh ibn Nabata. On another side, Habib ibn Amr. Habib ibn Amr says, we the companions, we could hear the ladies in the other room. He said, we can hear them crying, yes? We can hear Zainab and Kulthum. We had never seen them in our lives, but we can hear them crying in the other room. Because the lady gets affected the most when she sees her father is in a state of pain, yes? The daughter gets affected the most when she sees the father in a state of pain. Her heart is a soft heart. It's difficult for her to see her father in that state. So they said we could hear. And all of these companions were by Imam Ali's side. All of them reminiscing about Imam Ali. At this moment, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib turned around to Imam al-Hassan. He said, let my companions leave now. I have troubled them enough. Wallah, only Ali ibn Abi Talib has akhlaq like that. Oh, I have troubled them enough. Let them leave. So they began to leave one by one. They were outside, but they stayed outside. So then Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib heard them crying outside, yes? Imagine you knew Ali ibn Abi Talib. How difficult is it to see the Imam in pain? The father of the orphans, the father of the needy, the father of the poor. Yes, the father, Nadi Ali and Madhar al-Ajab, the person we go for all of our hajat. So they were all outside. Ya Imam, our tears tonight are from sinners, Ya Imam, yes? Our tears tonight are from lovers as well, Ya Imam. We wish we were by your grave, Ya Imam. So they were all outside. They were all crying outside. So then Imam al-Hassan told them all to disperse. They all left. Imam al-Hassan came back to Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib. He was sitting. Imam al-Hussein had completely fainted, by the way. One hadith says Imam al-Hussein fainted on his dad's chest. Then all of a sudden, they heard some crying outside.
night. When they heard the crying outside, Imam Ali said, I hear someone crying. Who is it? Imam al-Hassan went outside. He saw al-Asbagh. He said, Asbagh, what's wrong with you? Shouldn't you go home? He said, I can't go home. I can't leave Ali ibn Abi Talib. Let me stay here the night at least. So Imam al-Hassan returned inside. He saw Imam Ali. He said, Imam, al-Asbagh can't take this. He wants to stay outside. So the Imam said to him, come, let Asbagh come in. When al-Asbagh came in, he went straight to the chest of Imam Ali. Yes, he sat by it. He began to cry. Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib looked at al-Asbagh. He said to him, al-Asbagh, do not worry. Jannah awaits me now. In a moment, I'll see Rasulullah and I'll see Fatima Zahra. Do not worry, remain patient. I beg you, remain patient. The reply from al-Asbagh, wallah, it breaks my heart. He said to him, oh Imam, I'm not worried about you going to Jannah. Rather, I cry, how will I live in a world without Ali ibn Abi Talib next to me? How will I wake up in the morning and not see the holy face of Amir al-Mu'mineen in front of me? He began to cry with him. He hugged him. Al-Asbagh then left. Now it was the time for the daughters and the sons to come next to their father. Ya Allah, Ya Allah. Hassan came, Hussein came, Zainab came, Kulthum came. All of them suddenly started crying by the father. Sayyid Ali Khamenei narrated this masaib once in the most beautiful way. I want to narrate it like how he narrated it. He says that Hassan, Hussein, Kulthum and Zainab came near the dad. The dad, the poison from the strike had now gone all over his brain, yes? The poison was everywhere. So he says, Hassan began to cry, Hussein, Zainab, Kulthum. So he says, Imam Ali turned around to Hassan. He said, Hassan, calm down, I beg you. I want you to stop crying. So Imam stopped. Then he said, Hussein, I beg you, stop crying. He stopped. But when he saw Zainab crying, he began to cry with Zainab as well, because he knew there'd be a day when Zainab's alone. I say to him, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, if this was the tears, how about when Zainab ran from tent to tent in Karbala? Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, how about when they whipped her in Sham? Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, how about when she saw Ruqayya fall on Hussein's head?
Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Wa sayalamu alladhina zalamu wa yawma qalbin yanqalibun. Wa la'nati al-da'ima 'ala al-qawm. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to raise us with Muhammad and Al Muhammad. Ya Allah, raise us with the Imam of our time, Imam Sahib al-Asri wa al-Zaman. Ya Allah, remove the vicious lies that have hidden many Muslims from the love of Ahlul Bayt. Ya Allah, allow us to see the truth and allow us to see between the veils of the liars in Islamic history, in order that we're able to hold on to the Quran and the Ahlul Bayt. Ya Allah, allow us to receive the intercession of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi in this world and the hereafter. Ya Allah, allow us to visit his grave in the holy land of Medina. Allow us to sit by the grave of Rasulullah. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our Muslim brothers around the world, especially our brothers going through intense times of oppression at the moment, especially our brothers in Iraq. Ya Allah, bring peace and prosperity to all our brothers in Iraq. Ya Allah, peace and prosperity in Pakistan. Ya Allah, peace and prosperity to all of our brothers in Bahrain. Ya Allah, peace and prosperity to all our brothers in Afghanistan. Ya Allah, bring peace and prosperity to our brothers within the land of the Hijaz. Ya Allah, unite the Muslim Ummah on the love of Muhammad and Al Muhammad. For our brothers in the world today who are not feeling well, Ya Allah, bring them back to recovery. Haji Saftar, Haji Abdul Hussein, Ya Allah, allow them to come back towards the mosque, inshallah. Allow them to come back towards their families in safety and in prosperity and in peace. We pray with the ayah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Amma yujibu al-mukhtar wa idha da'a wa yakshifu as-su. Amma yujibu al-mukhtar wa idha da'a wa yakshifu as-su. Amma yujibu al-mukhtar wa idha da'a wa yakshifu as-su. From your hearts. Amma yujibu. at Karbala, Imam Zain al-Abidin. Ya Allah, cure all of our loved ones. And Ya Allah, unite the Muslim Ummah in this turbulent time. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with a Surah al-Fatiha, but before it, the loudest of your salawat.
Allahumma salli ala.